My sister Martha and I have been talking all week about your sermon on Sunday. It's really wonderful, Dr. Harper. In only 2 short years, you've taken on the spirit of Brooklyn.
That's very gratifying, Miss Brewster.
You see, living here next to the church all our lives, we've seen so many ministers come and go. Well, in the spirit of Brooklyn, we always say sprightliness. And, well, your sermons are not so much sermons as sprightly talks.
Personally, I've always enjoyed my talks on coffee and chips. Or have I messed with it?
No, dear. Not yet. Are the biscuits good?
Bully.
Won't you have another biscuit, Dr. Harper?
No. I'll have no appetite for dinner now. I always eat too many good biscuits to taste that lovely jam.
Oh, but you haven't tried the quince. We always put a little apple in it to take the tartness out.
Perfect.
Well, we'll send you over a jar.
No, you keep it here so I can be sure of having your biscuits.
Can't last much longer anyway. In the meantime,
more children a happier Christmas?
Well, it gives us something when we have to sit on the station. We get tired of playing cards. And then we just start playing again. First thing you know, you shut yourself in the foot.
Hey, go upstairs and get that big box from your Aunt Martha's room. How is Mrs. Brophy today? Mrs. Brophy has been quite ill, Dr. Harper.
Pneumonia. I'm sorry to hear that.
I'm going to eat some beef broth to take to her.
Oh, don't bother, Miss Abby. You've done so much for her, Eddie.
Oh, we made it this morning. Sister Martha is taking some to poor Mr. Benitsky right now. I won't be a minute. You just sit down and be comfortable, all of you.
She shouldn't go to all that trouble. When I received my call, Brooke moved next door. My wife fell. She died. Well, if I know pure kindness and absolute generosity are because I've known the Brewster sisters.
Colonel, you promised not to do that.
Well, I can't get the release of these supplies without calling a cabinet meeting.
He used to do that in the middle of the night. The interest rates came with us. I'm a little afraid of him, though.
He's quite harmless.
Yeah, and I suppose he does think he's Teddy Roosevelt. There's a lot worse people he could think he was.
Damn shame. Nice family like this hatching such a good group.
Well, his father, the old girl's brother, he was some sort of a genius, wasn't he? And their father, Jay's grandfather, seems I hear he was a little crazy, too.
He was crazy like a fox. He made $1 million.
Really? Here at Brooke?
Yeah, patent medicine. He was a quack of some sort, though. Such a dead wish, remember him. He used to use the house here as some sort of clinic. Tried to mock up people.
Yeah, and he used to make mistakes occasionally, too.
Department never bothered him much, though. He was quite head of gun autopsies, especially the poison cases.
Whatever he did. Till the doctor thought it's fixed for life. Thank God for that.
Not that they ever spent any on themselves.
Not well acquainted with their charities.
You don't know the sense of it. When I was with the Missing Persons Bureau, I chased this old man we never did find. Did you know there's a rental agency that's got this place down on Zillow's furnished rooms? They don't rent rooms or make them bed, and when he comes here looking for one, we'll go away with a good meal and a few bucks on a kit.
It's just their way of digging up people to do some good to.
Oh! Oh, isn't this nice?
Good afternoon, Miss Brewster.
Good afternoon, Mr. Brophy, Dr. Harper, Miss Klein.
How are you, Miss Brewster? We came to get the Christmas ones.
Oh, yes. Teddy's Army and Navy. They're all packed.
The Colonel's getting them right now. He has to call a cabin meeting to a gate, though.
Oh, yes, of course. Well, I hope Mrs. Brophy's better.
She's doing fine, ma'am. Your sister is getting me some soup for me to take to her.
Oh, yes. We just made it this morning. I just took some to an old man who broke ever so many bones.
Oh, you're back, Martha. How was Mr. Benitsky?
Well, dear, I'm afraid it's pretty serious. The doctor's going to have to amputate in the morning.
Oh, can we be present?
I asked, but it's against the rules of the hospital.
Oh. Well, I'm sure you could be of any service, and you must spare yourself something.
Here's the broth, Mr. Roby. Make sure it's good enough.
Yes, ma'am.
This is just fine. I'll make a lot of good tacking. That valley boy? Nuts about soldiers.
Oh,
go to Happydale Sanitarium after we pass on.
But why shouldn't we sign any papers now?
It's better to have it all settled. Should the Lord take you away suddenly, perhaps we can persuade Penny to commit himself. That would be an unpleasant legal procedure. Mr. Witherspoon knows her to be filed away until they're needed.
Mr. Witherspoon? Who's he?
He's a superintendent at Happydale.
Oh, Dr. Harper has arranged for him to drop by tomorrow or the next day to meet Penny.
Well, I'll be going home. Elaine will be overlooking with me.
Oh, give our love to Elaine. And Dr. Harper, please don't think harshly of Mortimer because he's a dramatic critic. Somebody has to do those things.
Did you just have tea? Isn't it rather late?
Yes, and dinner is going to be late too.
coming to after the show?
That'll be late, won't it?
No, we'll go to sleep no worse here tonight. From what I've heard about it, we'll be in place by 10 o'clock.
You ought to be fair to this place.
Are these plays fair to me?
I've never seen you walking on a musical.
Well, that musical isn't even opening tonight.
No?
Oh, darling, you've got some of the rules. In the musical, there is there's three changes of title and four postponements. The lights are a new day, but it needs a lot of work.
Well, I was hoping to you.
You're such a light mind.
Not a bit. Musicals somehow have a humanizing effect on me. I've been serious playing with George Miller's hair in the subway, and I listen to a lecture on the drama. But after a musical, you take me home in a taxi, and you make a few passes.
No, wait a minute, darling. It's a very inaccurate piece of reporting.
Oh, I will admit, after the Berman play, you told me I had authentic beauty. And that's all the thing disabled, girl. It wasn't until after our first musical you told me I had nice legs. And I have, too.
For a minister's daughter, you know an awful lot about life. Where do you learn?
In the quiet law.
I'll explain that to you sometime. The close connection with eroticism and religion.
Religion never gets decided in quiet law. Which reminds me, I'd better run over and tell Father not to wait up for me tonight.
Never been able to rationalize it.
What?
I'm falling in love with a girl from Brooklyn.
Falling in love? You're not stooping to the articulate, are you?
No, the only way for me to regain my self-respect is to keep you and be girl.
Did you say keep?
I've come to the conclusion that you're holding out for the legalities.
I can afford to be a good girl for quite a few years yet.
I can't wait that long. Where can we get married in a hurry? Stay tonight.
Well, I'm afraid Father will insist on officiating.
Oh, God, I'll bet your father can even make the marriage service sound pedestrian.
Well, are you by any chance writing a review of it?
Forgive me, darling. It's an occupational disease. I may get that place and I didn't know this.
No, darling. Don't pretend you know that.
You should tell your father not to go back with you tonight.
I think tonight I'd tell him better come two ways.
I'll telephone Winslow to publish the bands.
Nevertheless.
All right, everything formal and legal, but no later than next month.
Darling, I'll talk it up with Potter and set a date.
No, no, we'll have six in rehearsal. There'll be a lot of other first nights in October.
Hello, Mortimer.
Well, anyway, when Elaine comes back, I think we ought to have a little celebration.
When the curtain goes up, the first thing you'll see will be a dead body.
Thank you. came here looking for a room.
It was right after you moved to New York.
Oh, and it seemed like such a shame to let that lovely room go to waste when there were so many people who needed it.
He was such a lonely old man.
All his kids and kin were dead, and it left him so forlorn and unhappy.
We just felt so sorry for him.
Oh, that when his heart attack came, and he sat dead in that chair, looking so peaceful. Oh, remember, Martha. We made up our minds then and there, and then if we could help other lonely old men to that same peace, we would.
Is that right in that chair? How awful for you.
Well, no, actually, it was rather like old times.
What?
You see, Grandfather always had a cab or two lying around the house. Teddy had been living in Panama and thought Mr. Midgley was a yellow fever victim.
Oh, and that meant he had to be buried immediately.
So we all took the street down to Panama and put him in the lock. And that's why we told you there's nothing to be worried about because we know exactly what's to be done.
And that's how this all started. That man walking in here and dropping dead?
Well, of course we realized we couldn't count on that happening again, so...
Well, you know all those jars of poison up on Grandfather's portfolio shelves all those years?
Well, you know your Aunt Martha's knack for mixing things. You've eaten up her pickle.
Well, for one gallon of elderberry wine, I take one teaspoonful of arsenic, one half teaspoonful of strychnine, and just a pinch of cyanide.
Should I put a kid?
Oh, yes. As a matter of fact, one of our gentlemen found time to say how delicious.
Are your family Brooklyn people?
Haven't got any family.
All alone.
Hello, Al. It's Marshall. We got cut off. Look, Al, I can't come to that play tonight. That's all there is to it. I can't.
What church do you go to? There's an Episcopal church practically next door.
First Presbyterian. Used to be.
Well, what's George doing in Bermuda? Well, certainly I told him he'd go to Bermuda. It's my department, isn't it? Well, you gotta get a hold of somebody. You look around the office.
Is there always this much noise?
He doesn't live with us.
Well, what about the office boy? You know, the red one. The one we don't like? Oh, Al, there's gotta be somebody around the place.
I'd really like to see the room.
Well, it's upstairs, but won't you try a glass of our wine before we start up?
Never touch it.
It's elderberry wine.
Elderberry wine? I haven't tasted elderberry wine since I was a boy. Thank you.
Well, there must be some finish around the place. What about the fellow who sends my copy? Joe, he's the third machine from the left. Oh, but Al, he might be another bird's mantle.
Do you have your own elderberry bushes?
No, but the cemetery is full of them.
No, I'm not thinking, but I'm going to start now.
Use your mills?
Well, we might, but first we see whether you like our wine.
I suppose that always does make a man nervous. Well, I'm so happy.
Doctor. This is the home of my youth. As a boy, I couldn't wait to escape from this place. Now I'm glad to escape back into it.
Yeah, Charlie. It's a fine hideout.
Family must still live here. There's something so unmistakably Brewster about the Brewsters. I hope there's a fat calf waiting to return in the prodigal.
Thank you. you did that to me!
Now, Shani, you find a place somewhere, I fix you up quick.
Tonight!
Shani, I better eat first. I'm hungry. I'm beat.
Well, Jonathan, I'm glad you remembered us and took the trouble to come in and say hello. But you were never happy in this house, and we were never happy while you were in it, so...
My dear Tabby, I can't say that your feeling you just told me comes as a surprise. I spent a great many hours regretting the many heartaches it must give you as a boy.
You were quite a trial to us, Jonathan.
But my great disappointment is for Dr. Einstein. You see, I promised her that no matter how rushed we were in passing through Brooklyn, I'd still take the time to bring her here if one of Aunt Martha's home cooked dinners.
Oh, well, I'm sorry. I'm afraid there wouldn't be enough.
Abby, it's a pretty good sized pot roast.
Pot roast? Well, thank you, Aunt Martha. We'll stay to dinner.
Well, we'll hurry along.
Yes.
Oh, Jonathan, if you want to freshen up, why don't you use the washroom in Grandfather's old laboratory?
Is that still there?
Yes, just as he left it. Well, I'll help Martha get things started, since we're all in a hurry.
Well, if you get to kneel anyway.
Grandfather's laboratory, and just as it was, a perfect operating room.
After
you finish with me, we can make a fortune here in the laboratory, that large one in the attic. 10 minutes, Doctor, and we're going to scrawn for your tenants.
Fine, work yourself up, Johnny. Anyway, we're broken back in here a year too late.
You don't know this town, Doctor. Practically everyone is your face.
But so many of the old faces are locked up.
A very small percentage. And the boys in Brooklyn are famous for paying generously to stay in a jail.
Take it easy, Johnny. Your aunts, they don't want us here.
We're here for dinner, aren't we?
Yeah, but after dinner?
Leave that to me, Doctor. I'll handle it. Why, this house will be our headquarters for years.
Oh, that would be beautiful, Johnny. This nice, quiet house. Those aunts and your such sweet ladies. I love them already. I get the bags, yeah?
Just a moment, Doctor. We must wait until we're invited.
But you just said...
We'll be invited.
And if they say no...
Doctor, who helped us old women?
My comes through a beautiful dream. Only I hope you're not dreaming. It's so peaceful.
Well, that's what makes this house so perfect for us. It's so peaceful.
Well, this looks more the way you used to look, but I still wouldn't know you.
Doctor.
Yeah, I'd say no. Well, I know you two both want to get to where you're going.
My dear X, I'm so full of that delicious dinner, I'm quite unable to move a muscle.
Johnny, can I go down to the cellar? What do you think I find?
What? joke on my aunt's part. They're leaving the house with a body buried in the cellar.
How did he get him in?
Yes, we can't walk out the door. I know. We'll take Mr. Spinoza down and dump him in the bank. Come right back here then if you're trying to interfere. You're all going to, and this time you're going to be sober.
I fix you up beautiful.
And if you don't...
Jonathan, your room is ready.
And then you can go to bed. We're driving the car behind the house.
Well, it's all right where it is, but it's in the morning.
I don't want to leave you in the street. That might be against the law or something.
Secret?
Yes. A state secret.
Promise?
window open. You go run and let him through.
No, he's too heavy for me. You go outside and push. I stay here and hold him. And then together we can take down to Panama.
You open the window.
All
right.
Who left this open?
Explains everything. Just what did you mean by that? Why did you come in this time of night?
I thought I saw someone prowling around the house. I suppose it was you.
You thought you saw someone prowling around the house?
Yes, weren't you outside? Isn't that your car?
You saw someone at the car?
Yes.
What else did you see?
Just someone walking around the house with the car.
What else did you see?
Just that. That's all. That's why I came over here. I wanted to tell Miss Abby to call the police, but if it was you and not your car, well, I don't need to bother with
lights, Doctor!
Going somewhere?
arrived at the wrong conclusion. Take your suitcase and get out!
Jonathan! You're beginning to bore me! Why, you can't do one night stand in Brooklyn, now move on!
My dear Mortimer, just because you graduated from the Backbench and typewriter, I don't think you've grown up. I'm staying, and you're leaving, and I mean now!
Why, if you think there's anything that I fear, if you think I can be frightened...
Mortimer! I've lived a strange life, but it's taught me one thing. To be afraid of nothing!
Martha! Just look and see what's in that window seat!
No, I'm happy!
Yes, Jonathan, let's let Aunt Martha see what's in the window seat. I'm sorry, Aunt Abby. I owe you an apology. I have some good news for the both of you. Jonathan's just leaving and he's taking Dr. Einstein and our cold companion with him. Jonathan, you're my brother and you're Brewster, so I'm going to give you a chance to get out of this house and take the evidence with you. You can't ask for more than that.
Very well.
Not me. I'll have to call for the police.
Don't reach for that telephone. Are you still giving me orders after seeing what happened to Mr. Spinazzo?
Spinazzo?
Oh, I knew he was a foreigner.
Remember what happened to Mr. Spinazzo. What can happen to you two?
Better.
Murder? done that? Here in this house, and you buried them down there? I've got 13!
No, Johnny, 12.
13! There's Mrs. Spinazzo. There's the first one in London, two in Johannesburg, one in Melbourne, one in Sydney, and two in San Francisco, and one in Phoenix. The filling station. Then three in Chicago, and the one in South Bend. That makes 13!
But you can't count the one in South Bend. He got pneumonia.
He wouldn't have got pneumonia if I hadn't shot him! Count of me, Doctor. I say 13.
No, Johnny, you got 12 and they got 12. The old ladies are just as good as you are.
Oh, they are, are they? Well, that's easy to take care of. All I need is one more. Just one more.
Responsible for those, I can protect you, don't you see?
No, I don't see.
Goodbye, Jonathan.
Goodbye, Jonathan.
Perhaps you'd better say goodbye to Mortimer, too.
Oh, you'll see Mortimer.
Yes, I'll see Mortimer.
Oh. Well, that's all fixed up. Smooth like the lake. Nobody can ever help me sit down better. Come along, Johnny. Let's go to bed.
You're forgetting, Doctor. No, tonight, now!
Johnny, I'm tired, and tomorrow I got to operate.
Yes, Doctor, you're operating tomorrow, but tonight we take care of Mortimer.
Please, Johnny, not tonight. We go to bed.
Doctor, look at me! You can see it's going to be done, can't you?
Oh, Johnny, I can see. I know that look.
It's a little too late for us to dissolve our partnership.
Okay, we do it. But there's a quick way. There's a quick twist, like in London.
No, Doctor, I need this counselor. Something special. I think perhaps the Melbourne method.
Johnny, no, not that. 2 hours. Then it was all over once. The fellow in Melbourne was just as dead as the fellow in London.
We had to work too fast in London. There was no aesthetic satisfaction in it. But Melbourne, there was something to remember.
Remember? Oh, I wish I didn't. No, Johnny, not Melbourne.
Yes, Doctor. Where are your instruments?
I must do it, Johnny.
Get your instruments!
No, Johnny.
Where are they? Oh, yes, you hid them in the cellar. Where?
I won't tell you.
I'll find you, Doctor.
Curtain cord. Well, fine enough. A good idea. A very
asshole.
Yes.
And by the way, your cat, too.
You're right about that, fella. He wasn't very bright. That's what happened to the fella in the play.
They have that in the play, so.
formula days. There's hell to pay. The colonel blew that down to you in the middle of the night.
Yeah, the way that Amos McConaughey about it, you think the Germans are Dr. Bomb on Flatbush Avenue.
You did us on a war path. He says Colonel's got to be the worst of this.
Yes, yes!
Gee, Mr. Brewster, I guess I gotta get away. So, I'll run for the third act, quick!
Oh, get away from me!
Escape, she's wanted too. No wonder Brooklyn's in the shape it's in.
you imagine what happened with that cockeyed story about 13 bodies, if I remember? And now he's starting to develop a fever scare. You ain't.
13 bodies? Do you think anyone would believe a story like that?
Well, you can't be sure. Some people are just dumb enough. You don't know what to do sometimes. Now, about a year ago, this crazy guy starts a murder rumor over Greenpoint. I had to pick up half an ankle out just to put that body on.
Oh, excuse me.
Here, the graves are all marked. We put flowers on them every
pictures?
Please, I must have...
I'll just come right over, Doctor. Well, at one point last night, I thought the doctor was going to operate on me. Just come right over, Doctor. Just sign that paper.
Were you leaving, Doctor? I see that much.
Hello, Hank. Stick around, huh?
Don't worry, I'm going to.
Hello? Mac? It's Rooney. We got that guy that's wandering over me in the end. Now, there's a description of this accomplice right there on the desk beside you. Read it to me. Yeah? About 35, 5'4", brown eyes, 120 pounds, talks with a German accent, poses as a doctor. Thanks, Matt.
It's all right, Lieutenant. The doctor here just gonna get the signature.
Thanks, Doc. You're doing Brooklyn a great service.
Mr. Witherspoon?
don't quite understand. As head of that institution, I have to be quite alone.
That must make it very lonely for you.
It does. But my duty is my duty.
Well, Martha. If Mr. Witherspoon won't join us for breakfast, I think we should at least offer him a glass of elderberry wine.
Elderberry wine?
We make it ourselves.
Why, yes. Of course, at Happy Hour.